There is so much written about Waking Life because it is such a densely philosophical film. Every time I watch it, I get more out of it and I see things that I missed on the first, second, third, fourth, fifth viewing. It's that thick with philosophical themes. And there's a lot of good stuff written about it. A lot of stuff emphasizes dreams, and that is a part of it. But I would contend that running through all of these scenes is the emphasis on free will. And I have isolated about 8 different sub-themes that I want to kind of isolate and talk about in an individual way. But at the heart of all of those 8 themes is free will. Again, it all comes back to free will. And from a philosophical point of view, free will is that ability to choose from genuine alternatives. It means having the desire to do something and also having the capacity to do it. And it means not being compelled otherwise, being able once again to choose from among genuine alternatives. The movie starts off right away with the boat car. And that's our protagonist in the back, getting in the car like a cab and going along with the ride. And when the driver asks him, "Where do you want to go?" he says, "Oh, I don't know. Anywhere is okay." But that's where the person in the back, who happens to be our director, Richard Linklater, jumps in and decides for him and tells him exactly where to get off with an exact address. And the driver says, "Well, I don't know where that is, but it's somewhere." Meaning, if you don't stand up and take responsibility for your life, somebody else will. And just to say a few more words about that, when the driver says, "Well, I don't know where that address is, but it's going to determine the rest of your life," that reference is toward the determinists. In philosophy, there's this long-standing argument between free will and determinism. For the determinists, everything, our genetics, our society, our peers, our environment, all comprise forces or causes that act on us at any given moment, meaning no action is completely free. They're just a bunch of causes creating effects. And even our actions are just more effects. They're not totally free unless they're voluntary. But the emphasis in this movie seems to be on creativity as the liberating force. It does seem to support the presence of free will. Because that same driver says, "You've got to do what you can do with the crayons that you've been given." Meaning, yes, we've all inherited a certain number of crayons or a certain number of inherited characteristics, but it's what we do with that in a creative way that gives us our freedom of will. "Color outside the lines," he says. And running through that movie is creativity. That is what bestows upon us and reflects our freedom. So creativity will be one of those 8 themes running through this movie, along with free will. I love the way this movie celebrates creativity. You can see behind me my own watercolors. I feel that I am living out my potential and my truest self when I'm painting, when I'm creating. And I think that Linklater agrees. Here in scene number 2, we're taken into this idea right off the bat when the conductor yells out, "Just play a little bit out of tune." I love that. It's just like in the previous scene, the boat car, where the driver says, "You've got to color outside the lines." In other words, we are not a slave to our conditioning, to the script, to the written score of the musical piece. He's saying you've got to do your own thing, and we humans are at our best when we're being creative. And that's what music can do. That's what music has always done when it's at its best. For example, I'm a little older than you probably, but if you remember Woodstock in the late 60s, that's what musicians did. They gathered together to do more than just entertain. They were making a statement. They were setting out to change the world. They were saying, we can do things different. We can make the world better. We can be at our best when we're creating. They're saying that we are not enslaved to a script, and that's what the movie is saying. It all comes down to free will, though. Free will is exemplified through our creative genius. And the next theme is reality versus illusion, but we might also call it lucid dreaming, because to exemplify this theme, I'm going to point to scene number 21 called The Dreamers, with what my students have called the ukulele guy. And I love what he says. He says, to the functional system of neural activity that creates our world, there is no difference between dreaming, a perception, and an action, and the actual waking perception and action. So in other words, our brain doesn't seem to know the difference between imagination and reality. And it reminds me of that research that I read about where they were trying to figure out the power of the mind and the power of visualization and the strength of it and how it works on our bodies by hooking up some skiers to electrodes and having them mentally run through their ski run. And the brain doesn't seem to know the difference between the visualization of the act and the act itself. In other words, the mind thinks that it's skiing. It behaves the same way as if it was skiing. And that's the power of the mind. And that's the power of imagination. And the movie seems to be suggesting to us, what if we could harness that creative potential, once again, the power of creativity, and bring it into real life? Real life. Again, we're playing with the notion of what is real. It's like Chuang Tzu. Am I a man imagining I'm a butterfly or dreaming that I'm a butterfly? Or am I a butterfly dreaming that I'm a man? What is reality and what is illusion? And in that same sense, what is the power of the dream? And can I bring free will into my dream through lucid dreaming, through what we call lucid dreaming, or in other words, acting consciously and acting freely, again, free will, in the context of my dream? Can I be free in my dream? Can I be autonomous in my dream? Can I bring that quality of conscious control into my dream? Can I bring that quality of creative capacity into my dream any more than I can in my waking life? I mean, heck, we're not even living up to our creative potential in our waking life, least of all in our dreaming life. Can I do the same in both? Can I wake up in both? Can I wake up in my waking life? And can I also wake up in my dreaming life / lucid dreaming? That's what lucid dreaming is, being awake, being conscious, being an active participant and creator rather than just being a passive flotsam in the sea, subject to the causes acting on me. Can I be creative in my dream? This next theme we'll call the collective unconscious, an expression used by psychoanalyst Carl Jung in the 50s. You know, this refers to this idea that somehow the deepest part of our mind is connected like tendrils or straws tapping into a cloud or tapping into the same source. And to reference this point, I'll tap into scene 9 with Julie Delpy and Ethan Hawke, who were together in Linklater's Before series, Before Sunset and Before Sunrise, also, you know, having this talk fest, talking about deep things, and here they're talking about how in one part of the world you can have this crossword puzzle that's solved, or any puzzle that's solved, and somehow, on the other side of the world, at the same time, we get those answers in some mysterious, magical way. Like we've all tapped into the source. We're all connected in some mysterious way. And when knowledge is known over here, we're somehow able to access it over here. It also brings up that quality of creativity because we're creating knowledge and we're able to share it. Our next theme is evolution. But make no mistake about it, we're talking about an evolution of the mind, an evolution of consciousness, not evolution in its classical sense. And to exemplify this theme, I'll point to scene 17 called The Overman with Lewis Mackey. True evolution, he says, is an evolution of consciousness. And I liken it to Nietzsche's Overman, only coming from an Eastern perspective, which is what I normally teach. I think of the yogis who have it as a goal to overcome that which holds us back, our samskaras or our habit patterns. Here, it's explicitly asked, what is the greatest human weakness? What truly holds us back from our potential? Is it fear or laziness? Well, there, you can't really answer this question right because neither one is something to be proud of. And then it's suggested that there is a greater gap between history's greats and the average human than between most humans and chimps. Well, as an animal activist, I would say, of course there is. Chimps are pretty damn smart. But I also love the idea that is pressed in this scene, that again, so few humans reach their potential. It's really, this movie is an invitation to strive forward and think about what it would take to really set about to reach our potential. So many of us just follow along in the rut and in the ways that are expected of us rather than aiming high. But again, here we go again, back to that silver thread that runs through all of these scenes. And I argue that that quality is free will. This movie is once again pressing free will, and it comes forth in all of these scenes in its own way. And here again, it takes creativity to really exemplify that greatness and to use that freedom of will. We have to use it in creative ways. And our next theme is the problem of evil, that classic philosophical question of how does bad stuff happen in a supposedly benevolent universe or under the law of a benevolent and all good God? Well, to exemplify this theme, I'll simply point to scene 19 involving guns. The point seems to be that bad stuff happens. Of course it happens. But again, we come back to the notion of humans acting freely, and all of these themes, like our previous theme of evolution, are all cross-referencing, are all playing off of each other in all of these scenes. Because if we're not breaking free, and if we're not acting responsibly, if we're not taking personal responsibility for our actions, and if we are not evolving our consciousness, then we are like two-year-olds with guns. In other words, we're like a bunch of idiots with fancy equipment and fancy technology that we don't know how to responsibly use. And so Linklater seems to be proposing to us, how about if we break free and we evolve ourselves and evolve these qualities of compassion and creativity and use our smarts and our intelligence and our technology to become better people and to create a better world. Our next theme is personal identity, and to exemplify this topic, I'll point to scene 15 with the ladies talking at the table. Again, creativity, they're talking about how we create our identity as much as we create anything else. It's a construct. And so if I were to hold up a picture of myself at 7 years old and ask, is it me or is it not me? The answer would be, well, yes and no. And that boggles the Western mind, because we like to create these boxes and this kind of distinctive category of yes or no. But in fact, I need a story to connect the me of today with the me of yesterday. What will your story be? Will you use creativity in creating that story, and how will you construct who you are today? And our last theme, theme number 8, is connection, human connection. And to exemplify this topic, I'll point to scene 22, the wonderful holy moment with Kaveh Zahedi. In the East, God is everywhere. That's the pantheistic view, that God is in every being and especially in every moment. God is inseparable from nature. I love, love, love this scene, because they're asking you to be present, to break free from the script. Again, this takes us back full circle to where we started. It's like the conductor saying, don't follow the musical score, or like the driver in the boat car saying, color outside the lines. The best movies are those movies that aren't slavishly following a script. And so Kaveh Zahedi says, let's just be present with one another. Can we just maintain eye contact and be here with one another? Because all we really have are moments. We don't really have stories at all, funny enough. When we break even that down, all we have is this, just this. They reference Truffaut, my beloved French director, and my favorite movie of all time, The 400 Blows, which I hope we'll have time to watch together. Truffaut said that the best movies are those that break free from the script, and Truffaut loved Bazin. Bazin thought, like the Easterns, that God is everywhere. And so if we can just wake up, again, the movie is waking life. If we can wake up, we can wake up to God. And God is right here, right now. And God is in every one of us. And God is in this present moment. And we experience it. We have to experience it. We can't read it. We have to experience it. And how do we do that? By being present.